Chen. Welcome to the Dana Foundation. It's great to have you
great
here.
Great to be here.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Hello, and welcome to NeuroSociety Stories. This series is all about having meaningful conversations and sharing stories to show the great potential of neuroscience in society. I'm Caroline Montojo, President and CEO of the Dana Foundation, where our mission is to advance neuroscience that benefits society and reflects the aspirations of all people. Today, I am honored to be joined by our special guest, who is an accomplished athlete, author, advocate, and champion for neurotechnology through her own lived experience. I'd like to welcome Jennifer French, who is the founder and executive director of the Neurotech Network. It's a nonprofit focused on bringing the benefits of neurotechnology devices, therapies, and treatments to people living with neurological conditions. She won a silver medal in sailing for Team USA in the 2012 Paralympic Games in London, and she is co-founder of Warrior Sailing, a program for wounded, ill, and injured service members and veterans to develop maritime skills and build partnerships with marine communities. And most recently, Jen was awarded the 2024 Craig H. Nielsen Visionary Prize, which honors those whose innovative work and dedication have significantly improved the quality of life for people living with spinal cord injury. Wow. Jen, welcome.
Thanks, Caroline. It's great to be here.
It's great to have you. I think just to get us started, I'd love to hear a bit about your own story. You've always been an athlete, and I'm curious how you were introduced to neurotechnology.
I was not always a competitive athlete. I was more of an outdoor athlete. So outdoor sports was my thing. When I had my spinal cord injury from a snowboarding accident 26 years ago, that's when I got thrown into this world of disability. And even before my injury and even after my injury, I was in the consumer technology business. So I understood technology. After my injury, when I'm told that there's no cure for spinal cord injury, I started to look at what are the alternative treatments. And I didn't understand the biologics and some of the chemical treatments. Those were foreign to me and to some ways scary. But I understood technology. And that was my introduction to things like electrical stimulation for rehabilitation and a lot of other methods. That's what drove me to find a clinical trial in Cleveland where I became a participant of an implanted neuroprosthesis that allows me to stand and transfer and use it for other functions. With that, one of my aha moments was at a neural interfaces meeting on the NIH campus when I was sitting on a panel with people with a variety of neurological conditions, from hearing impairments to Parkinson's disease with other forms of paralysis. And we all had the same issues. We all had, how do we find this technology? It's very difficult to understand. And how do we build an understanding within the community so that people can access the technology?
Jen, you bring such a unique perspective living with an implanted device. In your view, can you share with us why you feel it's important for patient perspectives and values to be included in the research development process with neurotechnologies?
Yeah, absolutely. This is my 25th year of living with an implanted neuroprosthesis. And over those 25 years, I've seen the development of some fantastic technologies that have done some great things in the lab, but have failed in the marketplace. And why is that? So one thing that we have to learn about implanted devices is they are inherently personal. They're inherently interactive. And they are solving very complex neurological conditions that there's no other treatment for those conditions. So we have this area called the Valley of Death, and it is fraught with innovative technologies. And those technologies have failed for a variety of reasons, for a variety of systemic reasons. But there are inherent ways that we can help those technologies move along. And one of them that at least I see that we are really starting to pinpoint on is community engagement. And community engagement is not just helping developers understand the medical process, understand how people interact with the healthcare system, whether they're affluent or whether they're from an underprivileged community or whether they're in a rural part of America or anywhere in the world, is also understanding how they interact socially and how they interact with everyone around them and within their communities. How are their community norms? What are their values? What do they believe? And so it's not just training the developers, but making sure that we have that interaction between the community and people who are developing the technology so we can build the next generation in a smart manner.
I'm also just curious, maybe from a side perspective, did you expect that neurotechnology would be where it's at today, or has it exceeded your expectations?
I have seen huge acceleration with the help of the Brain Initiative. The investments that we made in the Brain Initiative have had significant impact on this entire industry, whether it's from the developmental side to what we're seeing from the commercial and investment side. So I think the public investment that we have in neurotechnology is really important. This is an emerging technology. This is an emerging field. And how do we help marshal that? And how do we help the people living with neurological conditions connect to the technology that is becoming available that could potentially be treatments for them in the future? We're at a point where we have investors coming in, but there's still systemic challenges that need to be solved.
Yeah, I appreciate that, Jen. Yeah, thank you for sharing that perspective also about the Brain Initiative and how that provided such a stimulus for the development of neurotechnology.
It was a shot. Yeah, it was a shot that the industry needed. Yeah. And it was at the right time, at the right moment.
The Dana Foundation has worked with you closely to establish something called the Implantable Brain-Computer Interface Collaborative Community. Long name, we can call it IBCICC as well. What inspired you to form a collaborative community around this topic?
The IBCICC is really at the intersection of neuroscience and society. We in society define implantable brain-computer interfaces in a lot of different ways, but the way that we define it within the collaborative community is that it needs to have three elements. One is it needs to be a device that's implanted under the scalp or in the cranial space via a variety of methods. It needs to be able to sense activity of the brain and to be able to interpret that activity. In most ways, it's usually typically software that interprets that activity. Third is it needs to take that activity and be able to either have restoration or rehabilitation for the user so that they can have a more empowering and independent quality of life. So those are the three elements of the way that we define it within the collaborative community. So what inspired us to start this? My collaborators, Lee Hochberg and Joe Lenners, we came together and really saw some key elements that we see in implantable brain-computer interfaces where a collaborative community might be able to help. We are at a pivotal moment of implantable brain-computer interfaces. We are moving from first-in-human and safety studies to larger studies and be able to make it available on the market today. That's how we have medical devices to be available to people to access them. We also have an industry, an emerging industry, that is ready to marshal this technology onto the marketplace. They are facing real challenges ahead. And those challenges cannot be solved by just industry alone, and they can't be solved by research, and they can't be solved by one entity or another. They need to be solved in a collective way by bringing in diverse stakeholders. So we need to find ways to be able to answer those questions, and we need to do it by bringing in multiple stakeholders. And what I mean by multiple stakeholders is it's bringing in industry, it's bringing in the research enterprise, it's bringing in our regulators, our payers, our hospital systems, our clinical community. But also importantly, we're bringing in the community. We're bringing in patient advocacy organizations. We're bringing in care partners. We're bringing in people with lived experience to help solve these systemic issues.
It's so interesting to hear about the diversity of stakeholders that are in this group and how that can overcome some of the challenges you were talking about earlier in terms of overcoming this valley of death that a lot of brain technologies that you've seen develop throughout the years have had to face. So it's wonderful to hear about that. What I also hope to hear from you is what you hope this implantable brain-computer interface collaborative community will achieve. And I know it's still early days, but if you could share some of the early outcomes that you're seeing so far as you build this community, love to hear those too.
Really, to start off, is that the support from the Dana Foundation has been pivotal for launching the IBCICC. We are focused on accelerating development to also improve safety and efficacy evaluation, but also to improve access for individuals so that they can be independent in their quality of life. So that being said, we have made some amazing strides. We had our first charter meeting in January of this year. We had 17 signatory organizations sign on as founding members. And I'm proud to say half of those were patient advocacy organizations. After that, we then got our federal liaison letter that allows our federal agencies to come into the collaborative community and work with us, which is a pivotal moment. And then in March, we launched the collaborative community. Once we launched, we really spent some time really intentionally listening to our community members from a diverse perspective and really getting in from them, what are all the issues? What are all the challenges that they're facing from the different perspectives that we have? So we've now culminated that and brought that into how are we going to organize our operations within the collaborative community. So right now we have, we operate via projects, and that's through our 7 work groups. So we have 7 work groups organized around very specific topics, around clinical outcome measures, around clinical practice guidelines, around ethics and data security, around interoperability and standards, around user preferences and user priorities, and also around how do we help engage with the public on implantable BCIs and how do we help to educate. And we do this all in a pre-competitive space and through the venue or through the methods of regulatory science. So with that, I'll give you an example. So for instance, our clinical endpoints work group has now developed a full list of all the possible clinical outcome measures there can be for implantable BCIs for various use cases. Now that we have this culminated list, which we've never had before, we've now trying to harmonize that list and understand each attribute of it. And really, eventually, we're planning on coming up with a menu of outcome measures that industry and research community can use and the regulators can use to be able to evaluate implantable brain-computer interfaces all on a level playing field. We're not very old, but we are now approaching 350 members within the collaborative community, and we just hosted our first public meeting in September.
I would say that those sound like much more than small changes. I mean, to be able to develop the first thorough clinical outcomes rubric is a major step for the implantable brain computer interface field.
Yeah,
it's wonderful. And it's been only 7 months.
I know. It's crazy. Yes.
And wow. My gosh, Jen. Well, congratulations.
Yeah, we have an incredible team of people.
Yeah. Jen, I would love for you to share what you think funders of neurotechnology should know. Do you have recommendations to share for those who are involved in funding or developing neurotechnologies?
We've made amazing progress with the support of many funders. So for instance, we've learned a lot about the human brain and the human nervous system, a lot with the help of the Brain Initiative and foundations like the Dana Foundation and others. We've built prototypes that we have proven in concept of being able to solve very complex neurological conditions and diseases. And we now have this young and very fragile neurotech industry that is ready to blossom. But we have a lot of gaps, and we still have a lot of critical infrastructure issues that need to be solved. And I think there's a couple of key areas where I think funders can help us. One of them, I think, is helping to bridge that gap over the valley of death, helping us to move from these small clinical trials to larger clinical trials to clinical adoption. So helping to bridge that gap is going to be incredibly important. Helping to drive innovators that when they start to build new technology, to do it with translation in mind, instead of just building a one-off prototype for proof of concept, but really to start to think about how is that technology going to be translated out. A third way is to help develop the clinical pathways. We have a very complex healthcare system, and how do we build clinical pathways for this technology so that it can be widely available, not just for people that live in metropolitan areas, but also those that live in rural communities? How do we build that pathway so that people in all of our communities can have access to this technology? And then finally, to help drive community engagement, whether that is through potential populations that could be end users, through community engagement, whether it's through public engagement. So I think those four areas are where funders can help us a lot in this space and can help drive neurotechnology in the way that we've never seen it before, where we can now diagnose, treat, and really deliver new treatments for people that are living with complex neurological and psychiatric conditions.
Jen, well, I want to thank you so much for joining us today. It was so inspiring to hear about your story of how you were introduced into this world of neurotechnology and also how you're building a community around it to help make sure that neurotechnologies can benefit as many people as we can have it benefit. And so thank you for sharing about that. I want to thank you and your collaborators for all of the work that you're doing to build this field for the benefit of society.
Well, thank you for the opportunity, and I truly appreciate all of our collaborators out there in the community, the support from the Dana Foundation and our other supporters of the collaborative community.
Of course. Thank you, Jen.